Good evening. Good evening. I'm Jennifer Rabb, and have a great privilege of being the president of this extraordinary institution, Hunter College, home of the Public Policy Institute at Roosevelt House. Yep, our college. This marvelous new book by our own Harold Holzer, the Jonathan Fanton director of Roosevelt House, and his distinguished colleague, Norton Garfinkle, is a major contribution to the understanding of Abraham Lincoln and his defense of the American economic system during the Civil War. This book also answers a critical question for many of us here at Hunter College, because to be candid, before we recruited Harold, we wondered whether hiring the nation's foremost Lincoln scholar as the Jonathan Fanton director of Roosevelt House was really such a good idea. Actually, and my friend Bill Vandenhoevel, who has the flame of the Roosevelts, was particularly anxious, okay? But just think about it, really. This is the New York home of Franklin Eleanor Roosevelt for 25 years before they moved to the White House. It is where FDR, of course, built the political career that would take him to Albany and then Washington, and is where Eleanor developed the passions and political skills that would make her one of the greatest first ladies. So did it really make sense to appoint a director who is steeped in the history of log cabins, not elegant Manhattan townhouses, an expert on a president who is famous for splitting rails and not one known for mixing martinis? Happily, this new book answers those questions wonderfully well and puts our minds at ease. Harold and Norton have not only given us a brilliant portrait of Lincoln as a defender of the common man, but as the architect of the American dream. They show us a president who believed in America's timeless commitment to build the middle class by keeping the doors of opportunity open for everyone. More than that, Harold and Norton show us Franklin Roosevelt as one of Lincoln's greatest followers, his kindred spirit in social and economic thinking. Roosevelt based his approach to the suffering of the Great Depression on Lincoln's statement that, quote, government has a final responsibility for the well-being of its citizens. He quoted Lincoln in the early days of the New Deal and again during his first re-election campaign when his programs were under assault from what he called economic royalists, and still again at the outset of America's entry into another great conflict, World War II. So whatever doubts we have harbored about Harold are now resolved. And we love the fact that he shares so much in common with his hero, Lincoln, like the ability to bring people together, get them to listen, and move them to laughter. We often call him Honest Harold. Now the connections between the book and Roosevelt House don't end there, because Harold's co-author, Norton Garfinkle, is committed to the Hunter mission and has often spoken to students on our campus. A just and generous nation simply strengthens our bonds with him. Norton is also one of our nation's leading economists. He is the chair of the Future of the American Democracy Foundation and the author of The American Dream versus the Gospel of Wealth. Norton, it's always a pleasure to welcome you back to Roosevelt House. And it is equally a pleasure to greet Dr. Eric Foner, who will be joining Harold and Norton in their conversation. Eric is the DeWitt Clinton Professor of History at Columbia. His book on Lincoln and slavery won a host of prizes, including the Pulitzer. Eric, too, has a close connection with Hunter College. Quite simply, the reason Eric is so smart and so accomplished is because his mother went to Hunter College. Liza Kratz Foner was a member of our class of 1929. So, Eric, we welcome you really, truly home. And in honor of your coming here tonight, I have for you a copy of your mother's commencement program from 1921. You will look and find her name in it under the honorable mentions for the Art Prize. So perhaps history, not necessarily in the blood. But we congratulate you and your extraordinary work for being members of the family, and I welcome you all here for what promises to be quite an extraordinary evening. Thank you so much and welcome.
It's great to be here at Roosevelt House and to be my job here is to ask some questions, some leading questions to the two authors of this very, very interesting book, and to throw my two cents in also from time to time. So you know who they are, and on your program there's a little more biographical information about Harold Holzer and Norton Garfinkle, so I'm not going to review their biographies. But since the first point, which is obvious to all of us, is that the theme of this book, economic opportunity and how to promote it or restore it, is, you know, part of our life at this moment. It is a central theme of the presidential campaign that is going on. It's in the newspapers just about every day. And this book really offers some really fascinating historical background on how we got to the point that the country is in right now. But I'm going to start by asking, since, well, we're not quite there, but next month Passover is coming along, and there are a lot of books about Lincoln out there, many thousands. Why is this book different from all the other books?
I was wondering where you were going.
Right.
Lincoln and Passover, that'll be my next book.
That book hasn't been written yet, probably. In other words, what led you, the two of you, to decide that another book about Lincoln was needed, since there are quite a few already out there?
Well, I'll start, because Norton and I have been friends for quite a few years, and we spent many wonderful lunches talking endlessly about Abraham Lincoln and his relevance to current struggles. And as economic discussions became really for 8 years, for several presidential cycles, Lincoln is perpetually injected into the campaign dialogue, and that's true this year as well. Hillary Clinton quoted Lincoln when she gave her economic message at another college, which will remain nameless, earlier, actually in 2015. Donald Trump has talked about Lincoln, Ted Cruz has talked about Lincoln, Marco Rubio. We have looked for a way to examine how Lincoln is correctly and incorrectly used, how his name and his legacy is used and abused. So that's my story of how we, and it just propitiously happened that it came out at a moment when Lincoln is being discussed again. I'll get to the most recent discussion, but that's my story. Don't disagree with the story.
I don't disagree with your story at all. I think it's perfectly correct. But there's another focus that is related to this, and it is the tendency of most, if not all, Lincoln biographers to focus on the battles of the Civil War. And that has caused us to overlook Lincoln's vision of the just cause of the Civil War. And one biographer, indeed, perhaps the most distinguished biographer of Lincoln, said, Lincoln did not come to conclusions quickly, and he was temperamentally averse to making bold moves. It was his style to react to decisions made by others rather than to take the initiative himself. Now, that's hardly a vision that gives us a perspective on how we can follow in Lincoln's footsteps and do some good for society. In describing Lincoln's first State of the Union message, this biographer went on to say it was a perfunctory document because it said little about the new reality of the battles to be fought in the Civil War. He said further, Lincoln's mission closed, in quotes, closed with an oddly incongruous disquisition on the relationship between capital and labor in a free society, and with the assurance that the struggle in which the Union was engaged was, quote, not altogether for today, it is for a vast future also. Now, that's what Lincoln said. That's not what the biographers had captured about Lincoln. They were so busy with the war and the frame of reference, and it took, I would say, four generations of Lincoln scholars and argumentative proponents of the southern side or the northern side of the Civil War to come out of the box and perhaps be ready to have a clear, concise, and we hope to say correct, point of view of why Lincoln fought the Civil War, what his vision was. This is the way that we confronted the issue, Harold and I, and decided that we had to tell the story as we could best tell the story of what Lincoln himself was about in the Civil War, and it was not all about battles.
Am I right that that was David Donald you were quoting?
I'm sorry to say it was, because David was my great friend, teacher, okay. And I agreed with him on absolutely everything except this Lincoln. One minor point.
Okay.
Can I just add one little postscript? I think an emphasis is always is put not only on military events, but also on Lincoln's allegedly mystical reverence for the Union. And we thought maybe it's a little too mystical. What did the serious question is, what did the Union represent to Lincoln? And we think it represented, at its core, economic opportunity, the right to rise higher than your fixed class, at least in a perfect Union, not in the Union, the parts of the Union that became the Confederacy, where fixed labor was the condition of life for most whites and all African Americans.
Well, that does lead us to the pretty central theme of the book, which is what you call the right to rise, economic opportunity. Now, what does slavery have to do? I guess the question is, why does that lead Lincoln to become anti-slavery? There are many people in the North at the time who talked about the right, you know, opportunity. It wasn't a very unusual idea, but many of them didn't seem to think that slavery for blacks posed any threat to the opportunity for Northerners, white people, right, to rise in the social scale. What's the connection between this belief in economic opportunity and his deep, you know, hatred of slavery?
Well, nobody has defined it better than you have. But, no. So since I've read your books, I think I'm qualified to give a good a starting response. And, you know, Lincoln warned often, whether it was for effect or seriously, about the potential for slavery to become national and perpetual. And on the very narrowest plane, the idea of slave labor competing with free white labor in the Great West that was about to open up was anathema to him just on that level. But, you know, there one can go so far as to absorb the psycho-historical version of the fact that Lincoln was rented out, so to speak. I'm not sure I completely buy this, but he had to do forced labor for his father, as so many frontier kids had to do. He didn't collect the money, and he thought, this is like being a slave. Maybe that's too much, but, you know, he was imbued with the idea that the American experiment meant more, as Norton says, than battles. He read Parson Weems' Life of Washington. He said, on his way to his inauguration, like old boys, I love the stories of the battles, but there was something more than that they fought for, something about the American experiment.
I think that's, of course, quite right. And slavery, obviously, is a contradiction to the notion of people who labor being able to rise in the social scale. The slave has no opportunity, obviously. But Lincoln and many other Republicans, as you know, also felt that the existence of slavery degraded all labor, right? That white labor in the South was considered degrading because it was associated with slavery. And so that even though it was confined to the Southern states by this point, it was still a threat to the dignity of labor, so to speak.
Right.
Now, though, if you read... Oh, go ahead, Norton.
Well, just to add to that, it's not just that Lincoln felt that we needed to get rid of slavery at some point. He felt that we needed to have a nation that was committed and dedicated not just to the right to rise, but to a just and generous nation that would help, that would be helpful to all citizens in their efforts to rise. And he really had a very communitarian point of view about what this all should be about, and he had a practical set of programs. From the first moment he was in Congress, he was supporting infrastructure. He was supporting building canals and roads and bridges.
Even before that, when he was the first time he ran for the legislature, it was to improve the rivers.
And the only patent that the president ever got was Lincoln's patent for helping boats to use their canals. The striking thing in America when Lincoln was becoming an early politician was the Erie Canal. And the Erie Canal had opened the West to the east and begun to create a national economic structure for the society. So Lincoln became the principal advocate of making and maintaining roads and bridges. He also...
Infrastructure, we call it, right?
Yeah, nowadays. Infrastructure today.
And we could use someone to maintain our bridges right now.
Exactly. And beyond that, he went beyond that. He wanted the government to provide for the helpless, young, and afflicted. He wanted the government to have an ability to dispose for deceased men's property, to have, you know, we had a national government with no budget. It took Franklin Roosevelt to get us from a 2% mm-hmm. budget to a 20% mm-hmm. budget, and back then it was less than the 1%. So Lincoln had a clear vision, unlike David Donald's description.
Right.
It was quite the opposite. He had a clear vision of what the government should be, what the government should do, and of all of our presidents, in anticipation of Franklin Roosevelt, he had the most complete and clear and vision of how our society, our national society, should be. He took Hamilton's vision of a government that was able to do something to apply it to what the government should be doing. And therefore, he was the Hamiltonian anticipatory of what Franklin Roosevelt ended up being able to accomplish.
It's well, come to me, that, has it? That he's Hamiltonian? And
yes.
Let me mention another great historian whose name is often connected with Roosevelt, is Arthur Schlesinger Jr., who wrote, of course, his books on the New Deal era. But before that, of course, he wrote The Age of Jackson, and many people still, I think, view the age that the Democrats were the party of the common man, right? Jacksonian democracy. And they were the ones talking about helping the ordinary American, and the Whigs were sort of aristocrats mm-hmm. or the simply the servants of big business of the time. And yet Lincoln was a Whig. So why, if Lincoln was so interested in helping the common man rise, why wasn't he a Jacksonian Democrat?
Well, just briefly, Arthur wrote many good things. And the worst thing he ever wrote
was... We're here destroying the reputation of many famous historians.
What was The Age of Jackson,
right.
Because Jackson was not a Democrat. He was an aristocratic slave owner, and he had the style of appealing to a large audience and perhaps anticipating
some future.
But what
was it in the Whig outlook that Lincoln, because, you know, right. Lincoln was a very ambitious person, obviously, and yet he was also a person who didn't sacrifice political principle for gain.
Right.
If you were a Whig in Illinois, you almost always lost. Lincoln was from one little district, which won, but they never elected
right.
a governor,
right.
they never elected a U.S. senator, so... When Lincoln joined the Whig Party, it was not the way to get ahead.
Well, it was
actually.
The anti-Jackson Party, and again, he...
Right. So what was it about the Whigs or the... that?
Right.
What put Lincoln in, before he became a Republican, into that position?
I think he was not did not have a romantic attachment to the land and to the people mm-hmm. who worked the land.
Mm-hmm.
He really believed, as he said, that everybody should have the opportunity to get rich, and he believed in investment, he believed in entrepreneurship, which we don't often associate with Lincoln, and,
mm-hmm.
and
no,
he
certainly.
Believed in banking, and Jackson was a disassembler of banking structures. And,
well,
and
yeah, he supported Lincoln. Now, if you read Schlesinger, the Bank of the United States was an aristocratic institution, and yet Lincoln supported it very strongly.
Well, Illinois went bankrupt well, as a result.
Jackson
but
destroyed
that's,
it,
yeah,
right.
Jackson
well,
destroyed it.
The reason for that is he believed in a national government.
Right.
And as did Hamilton, believe in a national government. And we were in a time in our society where there was essentially no national government. We went into the War of 1812
Very
without
weak.
An army.
Right.
And we busily lost the War of 1812 because we had no army. So
no one told Jackson, so we managed
yes.
to win.
Right. Right. Jackson did win a battle there.
Yes. But there was a national government idea that Lincoln had. But also his vision of opportunity. He grew up only in a middle-class society. There was no aristocratic class in the North in Lincoln's time. So when he was talking about opportunity for for all the citizens, and he was not objecting to people becoming wealthy. What he meant by wealthy were a middle class living, which he personally made, and he made that living until the time he became a year or two from the presidency by riding as a lawyer from place to place to place. So this is not an aristocratic. He had no experience in the Middle West of an aristocracy. The aristocracy was in the South, and when he talked about capitalists, he was talking about Southern slave owners.
Right. Lincoln, I think the key here, as the book makes very clear, and as you're saying, is what is the role of government? Lincoln, that's the difference, really, between the Whigs and the Democrats.
Right.
They both talk about opportunity, but the Democrats believe the government just get out of the way and let people compete, and the best will rise, whereas Lincoln and the Whigs felt that it was the role of government to create the conditions which would enable people to improve, public school systems, as you said, infrastructure, a bank to regulate the currency and things like that. And of course, this is not very popular nowadays, although it's coming back into style, a high protective tariff to make sure that other countries didn't flood the United States with goods produced by cheap labor and undercut the status of American manufacturing workers.
You know, so, one thing we should point out is that at the same time, and this is a speech that's been quoted with regularity in the last couple of months, Lincoln did not believe in one glamorous, galvanizing, towering figure that would dominate the political discourse.
In fact, he warned against it.
And he warned against it in his first major speech at the Springfield Young Men's Lyceum when he was 29 years old. Beware of a towering genius, by which he meant a tyrant, who would not come from abroad, but would come from within. And of course, there have been a lot of op-eds lately recalling that warning and trying to apply it to
Well, I don't know if our aspiring tyrants are geniuses right now, but...
they're marketing geniuses.
We do have some folks like that. Well, now another question, which, as you know, is very prominent in Lincoln literature nowadays, has to do with this question of who exactly is entitled to this right to rise. Did Lincoln include, let us say, African Americans in his vision of opportunity, upward mobility? The Democrats absolutely made clear they did not believe blacks were part of this discussion at all.
So even in Lincoln's first... Well, let me just say one thing about the debates. Even in his most retrograde performance, his debate comments at Charleston, Illinois, at which he was pushing back against charges that he believed in equality of the races. And
Negro equality. Amalgamation.
The right.
By the way, people who think that our political discourse today is at a low level are right, but it was fairly low back then also.
Very low. But in... So he's saying in this horrific moment that he never would support African Americans serving on juries or voting or intermarrying, quote unquote. But he did say of an African American woman, as his example, in the right to earn the bread, to eat the bread that she makes with her own hands, she is my equal and the equal of every other person. That's the basic, that's the start point for Lincoln, and
to the fruits of your own labor.
It is race blind.
Yeah.
It is race
for slaves as well as anybody else.
Right, that's the fundamental problem with slavery. For Lincoln, it robs someone of the fruits of their own labor.
Exactly.
Now, the fact is, though, that Lincoln says that, and that it was a fairly radical position in Illinois in 1858. On the other hand, he also said, as you know well know, that he didn't think blacks should have the right to vote or serve on juries or this kind of thing. And one could ask, well, how are they going to actually enjoy the fruits of their labor if they don't have any of these civil or political rights? And Lincoln had to think that through and evolved.
And was late to understanding that they were...
Right, and eventually, toward the end of his life, becomes much... much different. I want to move ahead because we are, we're moving in time. During the Civil War, not talking about battles, fundamentally important Economic legislation was enacted, the national banking system, the tariff, the income tax, they got rid of that soon afterwards,
the railroad,
the Homestead Act, the Pacific Railroad. Did Lincoln play a major role in the economic legislation of the Civil War, or was he mostly concerned with the military and slavery aspects and left those other things to Congress or what? Or did he keep an eye on economic measures during his administration?
I think I call him perhaps over enthusiastically the chief executive officer of the American economy, which during the Civil War became an enormously productive economy. Mm-hmm. The Civil War, before the Civil War, we were an agrarian society, mm-hmm. and Lincoln's vision was of a northern agrarian society, which he knew well, versus the southern slave society. He was busy trying to win the Civil War. He was busy encouraging all the industry that came along. One of your colleagues at Columbia has written about the great change that happened in the Civil War under Lincoln's, in a sense, leadership. Now, he was not literally running each of the companies that was suddenly becoming very big, mm-hmm. and we can't really blame him for the funny capitalist result that we had in the initial manufacturing capability of the North that came out of the Civil War, because he was busy building the economy and winning the Civil War, and that's about as far as he got. So I've been asked sometimes, well, why didn't he stop the rich people from becoming magnates and becoming the nascent billionaires? And he was too busy. He never spent any time, if any, certainly not much time, on those future issues because they were not visible to him and not part of his experience.
It's a classic, was he a Whig or was he a Republican president? So, you know, if you look at those, and Norton particularly called attention in not only in tonight's remarks, but in the book, to that first annual message, the equivalent of today's State of the Union messages, when he says that labor is superior to capital, which is an important, pretty radical statement. Yes. He also mentions legislation that is accomplished during sessions. He's clearly proud of the land-grant colleges, which is the bedrock of state university systems, of homesteading. He works aggressively on the railroad, you know, even during the Civil War, and gets that northern line that he and Stephen Douglas fought about so much. So I think he did pursue more than one would expect for a man who was totally consumed by the Civil War. One extraordinary statement that he makes in 1864, and I'm spending more time with this in when I give talks around the country, is this astonishing comment he makes. Well, we know we have suffered enormous losses, talking about the hundreds of thousands who had died, but I can happily report that our population has increased, which is a pretty shocking thing to say to the widows and orphans of the Civil War. But what he's talking about is immigration.
Yeah.
And he is extraordinarily proud and encouraging of moving people into the workforces, into the factories. And I think he's thinking about educated labor, productive labor, even during the war, not just as potential soldiers, but as workers in the factories and the mills. So I think he's thinking about it.
So the Civil War is, among other things, the triumph of this ideal of free labor. Slavery is destroyed. Free labor is now the dominant, you know, system in the country. And yet, as your book shows very clearly, if you fast forward a generation, suddenly Lincoln's America no longer seems very viable. You have the Gilded Age. You have the robber barons. You have a vast inequality of wealth. Some people blame that to some extent on some of the economic measures of the Civil War, particularly the banking system, the national banking system, which really consolidates banking power in Wall Street. Not that that was Lincoln's purpose, but that was one of the consequences. So how do we get from Lincoln as the proponent of opportunity for everybody, to the Gilded Age and vast inequality, labor conflict, and, you know, real social turmoil over this.
Okay, so we get there very straightforwardly in the following way. Lincoln himself believed in a government that would work for the people. And there are certain things that he did. The Morrill Act to establish our nation's state colleges and universities. The Homestead Act, providing 160 acres to Western settlers. So his vision, which was an agrarian vision, he grew up in an agrarian northern society. We were not yet an industrial country. We became an industrial country during the Civil War, and Lincoln did not have time to consider any of these future issues because they were not visible to him or to anybody at that time.
Right.
But they came, and Lincoln was no longer the president, as we say. And what happened, happened without Lincoln to guide the nation. And what happened was a situation in which the North moved toward this libertarian economic theory, which had some rather unfortunate aspects to it. The South returned back to their new sharecropper system, which was their modern version of the old slave system. And we had a period of at least 40 years, perhaps 50 years, of both the North and the South going in different wrong directions. And they were not the country, neither the North nor the South was moving in the direction that we would like to think our society should always have moved. And it was not until Teddy Roosevelt came along and Woodrow Wilson came along and then we reverted back to the non-egalitarian society in the 20s, and when Franklin Roosevelt finally came along, he was able to build our modern meritocratic society.
Well, since we are here in this Roosevelt Institute, Harold, what was Roosevelt's view of Lincoln or sense of connection with Lincoln? They were different political parties, obviously.
You know, you go back to Roosevelt's second gubernatorial run in New York to find his first recorded expression of interest in the Lincoln legacy, of seizing the Lincoln legacy for the Democratic Party, in believing that the people who were becoming his broad constituency, including African Americans, should be wholly Democratic. And, you know, he didn't win the African American vote until his second term running for president. They remained the party of Lincoln extraordinarily, I mean, because obviously it's not in their interest to vote for Democrats in the Deep South, so they voted for Herbert Hoover in 1932. But he uses Lincoln in several ways. He uses Lincoln to justify government assertiveness in the wake of crisis. And then again, he uses Lincoln, I think, most effectively in the run-up to World War II, when he actually hires Robert Emmett Sherwood, the author of Abe Lincoln in Illinois, to be his speechwriter, to be one of his speechwriters. And Abe Lincoln in Illinois is a play built on an absurd premise that Abraham Lincoln did not want to be a leader, that he had to be pushed in the direction of leadership against his nature. His wife was pushing him, his friends were pushing him. He finally agreed to take over the country somehow, we don't know how, in the play, but he reluctantly agrees. And this was the image of the reluctant warrior that Franklin Roosevelt cherished. How do you get an isolationist country to engage the rise of fascism without thinking that FDR was a military adventurer? And the way he did it was to suddenly talk about Lincoln and Lincoln's moral indignation at wrong and his reluctant warrior status.
Given what you just said, that the segregationist South was such an important part of the Democratic political coalition, then how did Southern Democrats react to Roosevelt's trying to appropriate Lincoln for the Democratic Party? Lincoln wasn't all that popular in the South.
Roosevelt had a way of dealing with the with the Democratic majority and getting them to around the New Deal, even though basically they weren't. You know, he was just brilliant at it.
But basically, Roosevelt understood the concept of the potential disadvantages of extreme capitalism, as did Lincoln, and he understood that early on. By 36, he knew that he was, Roosevelt knew that he was in a battle with the rich tycoons, the billionaires of the time, and he literally undertook to fight against them, and the 36 election was a clear election in which Roosevelt, they were the enemy, they were trying to prevent the New Deal, and he was there for the people. And then he elaborated, and he literally, Roosevelt elaborated what our modern middle-class society commitment is, and he did things like government economic regulation of the financial economy. He undertook unemployment insurance, Social Security, protection of workers and the right to organize, and the GI Bill, which became the ultimate commitment of a positive government to create a new middle-class society, which succeeded until
let us not forget it was completely segregated, the GI Bill.
No, no,
and
absolutely.
Certainly in the South, black veterans could not take advantage of it in any way, nearly the way whites
were. I think that's absolutely right, and it's perfectly appropriate to say that neither Lincoln initially was devoted to complete equality of treatment, nor Roosevelt, because he was a politician and
Southern control of Congress.
Right. And that base went away from him in 1940s, away from the Democratic Party in 1947, and it took the Democrats, whatever, a decade or two to realize.
I think in this House it would be very prudent and appropriate to mention that while Abraham Lincoln had only Mary Lincoln to hector him in late evening about things like redecorating the White House and changing his ideas of whom to appoint to office, Franklin Roosevelt had Eleanor to move him in the direction of slowly but surely toward equality of treatment under the New Deal. So in this, of all places, we have to remember to celebrate Eleanor as well, especially in Women's History Month. Right?
She was a very different person than Mary Lincoln, although Mary Lincoln sometimes gets too bad a press.
Yeah.
She was a very educated and savvy observer of politics. Her father.
She was an observer of politics.
Yeah, no, she wasn't like Eleanor Roosevelt.
Right.
I don't think that role existed at the time of it. But anyway, we're almost out of time, and we're going to have questions. But let's come all the way up to the present, as the book does, and since we are in the midst of this presidential campaign, where economic inequality and the shrinking middle class and issues like that are very much on the front burner. I'm not going to ask you what would Lincoln do today, who would Lincoln vote for, Cruz or Trump or somebody else, but are there any lessons that we can learn from this study that you've given us about how to deal with what seems to be a fairly serious problem in our society right now?
I think that the Lincoln's tenets of malice toward none, of government of, by, and for the people are worth remembering in this season. And when people come to me and say, how can you bear it when so-and-so quotes Abraham Lincoln? Or how can you bear it when so-and-so quotes Abraham Lincoln? I say, who would you rather be an ideal for both the Republican and Democratic parties than Lincoln? Whatever version they're constructing, the idea of unity and fair treatment, if they can somehow all get to that, is Lincoln-esque and is a viable ideal for now as it was then.
Mm-hmm.
I got out of that one nicely.
Okay, and Norton, what do you think?
And just to add briefly, we should be reminded that the concept that this nation and this government should be for the people was an invention of Lincoln's. No political figure before Lincoln focused on government for the people, and it took Franklin Roosevelt to finally get back to that concept of government for the people. And we're losing. We've lost that concept starting in 1980. And we today are not a government for the people. So the question, another way of answering the question is we have to look at the candidates that are out there and ask ourselves not who is going to remove as many restrictions as possible so that rich people can get richer and richer without paying taxes and will balance the budget with less and less money for the national government, therefore not doing anything for the people. So our task is to find new leaders who understand this concept of for the people, and in a funny kind of way, they really don't have to write a new template, because Roosevelt's template is still there, has been abandoned, diminished, and we can go back to that and find it as the template for us, and the voters can find the concept, Lincoln's concept of for the people, and Roosevelt's execution of that concept gives us perfect guidance for the future.
Okay, well, thank you. On that note, I'm going to open the floor to questions. So if anyone, yes, sir. Yes, would you want to stand? Oh, there is a mic, good.
Thank you. I just finished Eric Foner's book. I'm very much looking forward to reading this book. Given the current political climate, Lincoln was against the expansion of slavery into the territories because he felt that would hamper the right to rise. He was for high tariffs to protect the American worker. He was one of the last believers that African Americans would want to voluntarily leave the country and colonize Haiti or some other place. Do you see elements of, and he was talking to a white working class audience, do you see elements of Trumpism in Lincoln?
No.
No, that's a stretch.
Yeah, I don't see elements of Trumpism. I mean, the tariff, it's such a totally different economy that I don't think you can draw parallels between protectionism then and now. And on the dicey subject, the legitimately raised, of colonization, Abraham Lincoln was enthusiast for the colonization movement when his hero Henry Clay introduced and popularized it as sort of a philanthropic gesture to find an area where African Americans could control their own lives and destinies and governments. I believe, and Eric and I have had this discussion many times, that his alleged enthusiasm for colonization, which lasted until African Americans began enrolling in the Union Army, was sort of a device to push back against charges that he had just been so radicalized that he could no longer lead the country. But that's a long, long story. But in short, I don't see Trumpism in it.
No, I don't think he, not at all, not at all. But the colonization is an important issue.
Yeah.
And I think the way to think about it is that it was, Henry Clay, as you say, devised this, it was part of a plan to get rid of slavery with the consent of slave owners. Because before the Civil War, there was no way you're going to abolish slavery if the slave owners don't go along with it. The federal government couldn't just pass a law saying slavery is now abolished. And this was a sweetener. Colonization, because they didn't want a large free black population. Compensation, money would go to them to compensate for the loss of property. And it would be very gradual. Lincoln held to that plan until the Emancipation Proclamation. But once you have the Emancipation Proclamation, you're saying, forget it. We don't care what the slave owners say. Slavery is going to end, and therefore you don't need those other sweeteners. Now, it's still reprehensible in some way to say to black people who have lived here and worked here, Lincoln never said you must, but you should leave the country and enjoy your ride somewhere else. But Lincoln outgrew it, which is, you know, I think one of the elements of his greatness. He was able to overcome early prejudices and really reach a much higher level of belief in equality toward the end of his life. Okay, let's see. Yes, over here, sir. Wait for the microphone.
Hi, a bit from left field. In 1859, Peter Cooper founded a school in New York for free to advance working men. What, in your view, was the philosophic and possibly personal relationship between him and Lincoln, if any?
Well, I think the most important relationship is that it became that he was on stage when Peter Cooper was on stage when Abraham Lincoln arrived there, even though he arrived in New York in February 1860 believing he was going to speak at the Plymouth Church.
Right.
Still didn't know that the venue had been changed, and then found out he was speaking at this new, relatively new, free college downtown, or I guess it was uptown then. Of course, triumphed there with his extraordinary Cooper Union address. So I think that's the relationship, is that Cooper is there along with Horace Greeley and William Cullen Bryant and others expecting to see the debater who is famous for his homespun stories and loud and oratory, and to find this scholarly, to hear this scholarly speech that's so surprising, I think, changed history.
And don't forget that Peter Cooper ran for president in 1876 at an age higher than Bernie Sanders is today, with a kind of Bernie platform. He was the candidate of the Greenback Labor Party,
right,
which, as unusual, since he was a millionaire iron manufacturer, but he was the champion of labor and trying to put forward a program to deal with some of these problems that Norton was talking about.
There were three
about.
Presidential candidates on stage that day.
Is that right? Who was the other?
Horace Greeley.
Oh, Greeley, of course, 1872,
ran
right.
Grant, sort of the McGovern of his day.
Right, exactly. yes, okay, all right, so that was quite a day at Cooper Union. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Just a quick preface before I ask my question. My name is Alice LaBrie. I'm former U.S. Department of State. I live in Harlem. I'm a Republican. I am so grateful to be here to hear your talk, because real quickly, I saw Waite Rawls, who was president of the Museum of the Confederacy, which is now called, what, the Civil War Museum?
Right.
And I said, what? I haven't heard that. So I went to the Civil War Institute in Gettysburg, and I heard different views for 4 days. But on the opening night, the director of the Civil War Institute was just trashing the South. And finally I said, sir, with all due respect, somebody had to pick that cotton. And it was a labor issue. I'm sorry they chose that form of labor, sir, but it was a labor issue. So I was very pleased to hear this discussion today. And I didn't know it was on CNN, and when I got home to Harlem, it didn't go so well.
Oh. Well, it just shows you how varied experiences are and viewpoints, and I always like to see you at all of these events, and I'm glad you came to Roosevelt House. I've been missing you.
Very good. Okay, any other question? Yes, right over here. We're giving the microphone person a workout.
Thank you. I'm Andrew Polsky, and among other things, professor of political science here at Hunter College, and I've done some work on Lincoln. One of the things that you didn't talk about tonight, though, was in tracing the line from Hamilton through the Whigs to Lincoln, that there was a very profound change going from Hamilton to the Whigs in the view of executive power. The Whig Party was right. Very opposed to the use of executive power, and Lincoln had to carefully move around that when he became president to fight the war. But I want to go back for a moment to the question of his role in creating the economic policies of the Republican Party during the war, because it would seem that as a Whig leader, he would be very deferential to Congress. And I haven't really heard any clear statement that he was an active leader in pushing that legislation through Congress. Can you give us an example of some of that legislation, of his role specifically?
Well, let me just mention, to introduce this, here is Lincoln in December of 1861, and he's delivering a speech to Congress in which he delineates his economic philosophy, and he proposes all of the legislation that involved active government role in not just the National Banking Act, but all the good things that we would look to as beginning actions that might support a middle-class society. Why did he do it? The Civil War had started. The war was there. The battles had to be won. He did it because he had a clear point of view as to what the government should do and should be doing, and the sequence of things that he was proposing was a sequence that was not Whig. It was Whiggish in the sense that the national government had a role to play, but the notion that these schools, these agricultural schools that would be in all the states of the Union, the notion that individuals could go west and get 160 acres, these were notions of a government for the people. And Lincoln had it clearly in mind, and he did not let the war stop him. He knew that here he was lucky. All the Southern senators had left. All the Southern representatives had left. Therefore, he had large majorities in both houses of Congress and was able to provide his list of legislation and get it all passed right away.
Let me do a narrower answer to Andy's question. I think he was Whiggishly careful to keep his fingerprints off direct legislative action. It just wasn't done. But in the meetings, in the constant flow of meetings and discussions, I mean, Senator Morrill is recorded as visiting the White House 17 times in the, something like that in the period when the Morrill Act is coming up for the second vote. I don't think there's anything quite as active as we know, not just from Spielberg, but we know from history, the way he forced the 13th Amendment vote, some say, some feared prematurely. There's nothing quite like that. But I think Norton's right that the list is there, the inclination is there, the pen is there, the majority is there. So it's just cascading. It's like the Great Society without, you know, that kind of direct Johnson-esque laundry list. But I think it's a collaboration. I really do. Unlike other Whig/Republican presidents, unlike other 19th century presidencies.
Okay. Yes.
Hi, I'm George Tebow, a neighbor. And so if he had lived, what would he have done in his second term that would have changed the course of economics and opportunity in the next couple of decades?
Eric, you should answer this, too. One of these nice counterfactual questions.
We have enough trouble figuring out what did happen than trying to decide what might have happened. But we are always asked this, of course. What would have happened if Lincoln hadn't been shot? Usually it's related to Reconstruction. Would Reconstruction have worked out differently? I have no idea.
About Reconstruction.
Right, but it is true that Lincoln was succeeded by probably the worst president in American history. Yeah. There is a certain competition for that slot, but I think Andrew Johnson has a very good claim. And someone who lacked not only Lincoln's political skills, but his compassion for the former slaves and his willingness to use the federal government to, I mean, on these, putting Reconstruction aside, on these economic issues, Johnson was completely the opposite. He was a Jacksonian Democrat who believed in very, very weak government. When he was in the Senate, he voted against every appropriation that ever came up. He didn't think the government should do anything. But it's impossible to say what Lincoln would have done on these economic issues because the real question was Reconstruction at that point. And the economic crisis didn't really arise until 1873 the Depression of the 1870s, by which time Lincoln would have certainly been out of office anyway. But, you know, there are many things of Lincoln's floating along the internet. Not all of them totally reliable. One, you may get this question now and then. People email. I've seen this quote on the internet. Lincoln said, now that we have destroyed slavery, the next battle is to attack the bourgeois, you know, ruling class or something for labor.
That was Norton's last quote.
I'll respond with another quote from Lincoln, which is, don't believe everything you see on the internet.
The one way I sometimes answer this question, and you're right, it invariably comes up. It's the great what if of the Lincoln scholarly community and the public, obviously, is that in his final speech, Lincoln says that he wants people to consider extending the right to vote to African Americans, at least the very educated and those who have fought in the army, which sounds like means testing today and terrible restrictions, but in fact represented the first time any American president ever publicly called for the right to vote for people of color. Yeah.
Right.
John Wilkes Booth really was in the crowd that day. He really did, at least I verified one part of the quote, turn to one of his Confederates, small c, or capital C, as the case may be, and said that's the last speech he'll ever make. Now, what happens if he fights for the franchise for African Americans in the South? Doesn't that change the labor system, potentially change the labor system? One can hope that that might have been
the case. By the African Americans did get the right to vote in the South two years later, for 7 or 8 years, or depending on the state, and it didn't seem to affect the labor system all that much. This is a question for Norton. Does the right to vote change the labor system? I mean, in the North, working men had the right to vote, and that didn't enable them to prevent the Gilded Age, inequalities.
And the answer is no. And perhaps the best answer is that the only thing on Lincoln's mind at that time was bringing all the states back into the Union, without acknowledging that they had ever been out.
Right.
And that was his focus. And he was not focused on any other economic issues. The issue of for the people was sort of not on the table, as it were. There was nothing on his list. He had already accomplished his contribution.
His economic agenda.
Economic agenda. He did it in the first year when he had a majority in the Congress. And he had nothing else particular on his agenda other than getting the people back, getting the states accepted back into the Union, and he was not working very hard to get votes for African Americans process. He was not against it.
I hate to end on a disagreeing note, but like we can just agree to disagree.
Okay.
Right.
And
it's a little more complicated than that.
Whether
right.
people don't use their franchise to vote for leaders who work in their interest,
give them
the opportunity.
What is governing the economic system may not be susceptible to people's votes, so to speak.
Yes,
I mean, the price of cotton, for example, was falling the whole period after the Civil War, and there wasn't much you could do by voting about it. But anyway, we have time for one more question, I'm told. So, yes, over here. Wait until the microphone comes around, okay? There it is.
Garfield allegedly was a progressive president. Another what if he hadn't been assassinated, where would Reconstruction
have gone?
Now,
that's the first time I've ever
heard that
question.
I know, that's a new one. Congratulations. Coming up with a new question is not easy, so we commend this gentleman.
Do you want to do what if Garfield had lived? That's you, Eric.
I am stumped by that question, quite honestly, and I don't remember. What did Garfield actually do in the period he was in, apart from... I guess civil service reform comes under Arthur, really, more.
Yeah.
But I can't
we wouldn't have had civil service reform.
I can't name you an accomplishment of Garfield at all during his presidency. This is my fault. I'm sure Garfield was a very effective leader, but I have forgotten all his accomplishments.
Ron Chernow is writing a new book on
Grant. Not Garfield.
But Ron is very careful and elaborative. Maybe he'll touch on Garfield.
All right.
Well, he's one of Grant's generals. So why
Garfield was a radical Republican during Reconstruction, so he probably would have tried
general.
To do. He probably they were still debating in 1881, 82 whether to intervene in the South again to assist to where black people were having all their rights, which were now in the Constitution, abrogated in the Southern states. So maybe if Garfield hadn't been assassinated, you might have had a more vigorous effort to protect the basic rights of the former slaves, but we don't know. No, more than 4 months, more than a year.
No, about 18 months, I think.
Yeah, I think it was 82 he was shot, but we'll have to look that up on Wikipedia. anyway, thank you all very much for coming. Thanks to the two, and I commend the book and urge you all to pick it up and purchase it and read it.
So on behalf of Jennifer Rabb, we're inviting you all to a reception upstairs. And,
good.
Please join us.
Okay.